means is associated with cardiac disorders. It means how can we diagnose the different disorders of the heart by using different tests. So in previous classes we have seen about biochemical markers and imaging studies, and today's class we will see about non-invasive stress testing, right? Wherein which going to the topic. So these are the introduction parts, what we have seen about physiology and blood flow in the heart and different kinds of studies for the heart. And today we'll see about non-invasive stress testing. So what do you mean by non-invasive stress testing? So in here, in non-invasive stress testing, we can perform this test with the help of exercise stress testing method or pharmacological stress testing method. So this exercise stress testing method is for those people who have heart problem and who can do certain exercise problem, certain exercise or activities, right? And pharmacological stress testing is for those people who have heart problem and who cannot perform the exercises. Suppose think 70 years of patient who came to you with a coronary artery disease like CAD, right? And when you want to perform this non-invasive stress testing to this person, as the person is having the joint problems where he cannot walk, what we can do is we can use certain drugs to the patient where the stress will be increased and the pressure increased to the heart, through which we can find out the images of the heart, like before exercise or before giving the drugs, and after exercise and after giving the drug, right? So first thing here is exercise stress testing. So we'll see what is exercise stress testing here, right? So in exercise stress testing, we'll be asking a patient to perform certain exercise activities, and we'll be seeing the patient's heart functioning capacity and remaining heart functioning capacity. Means when you are going to perform this exercise stress test, it means the person is having certain cardiac related problems, right? We can see how much amount of heart is working and how much amount of heart is not working, or what part of heart is having a problem, right? In exercise stress testing, generally we'll be using treadmill, like, you know, when we go for gym and there'll be treadmills which you will be walking, right? Apart from this, we can use upright bicycle. Supposing if patient cannot stand, so we'll be using cycle. So this one also, the cycle or bicycle also will be seen in gyms or in the normal internet also will be seen, right? So to perform this treadmill, we'll be using a graded protocols, right? So one of the best protocol which the world using for now or till now is Bruce protocol, right? The Bruce is a American cardiologist, heart doctor. So he invented or he introduced this Bruce protocol in the year 1963. And later there is a modification to this protocol. So in detail, we'll see in upcoming session what is Bruce protocol and what is a new or modified Bruce protocol. For now, you remember Bruce protocol is a exercise graded protocol which we'll be using to perform exercise stress testing, right? So along with the exercise stress testing, we'll be using myocardial perfusion imaging. What is myocardial perfusion imaging? So with the help of this myocardial perfusion imaging, we can see the blood perfusion in different parts of the heart, essence like from auricle to ventricles, or in the arteries, or in the veins, or in the myocardium, right? With this myocardial perfusion imaging, you can see the blood perfusion rate. And next one is echocardiography. Like in previous classes, we have seen when we are performing this echocardiography, we'll be using this exercise stress test also. So with the help of this echocardiography, what we'll do is when we ask person to do exercise, right? And we'll be seeing the changes in the different parts of the heart. So if you can see this one, take an example here. If you can see this one here, what happened here? This red color part and blue color part. So here there is a decreased red blood flow. These are the arteries where there is a decreased blood flow, and they are at high risk, high chance of risk, like infarcted myocardium, means there is a damage to the some part of the heart, right? This red color is normal arteries where there is normal blood flow, and this blue color parts are the arteries where there is a decreased blood flow, which can cause ischemic heart disease, which can cause coronary heart disease, right? So when it comes to this black color part, MVO and IHM, which leads to there is increased oxygen supply, but because of ischemia, ischemia means there is a lack of oxygen supply to the different parts of the body, myocardial ischemia. There is a, this is a major reason where you can find out, major part where you can find out the problem of the heart, right? And the next one will be, who will perform exercise stress test? EST means exercise stress test. Now we'll see who will perform. Patient who are having chronic stable coronary artery disease. Coronary artery disease means the arteries which are present in the heart, in the part we call as coronary arteries. If there is a problem to that arteries, we'll call as coronary artery diseases. And other patient who is having myocardial infraction. So what is myocardial infraction? Right, when there is a damage to the heart parts, we'll be having a disease condition called as myocardial infraction. And that third condition is, we can see the person's function, person's heart functioning capacity, right? And this test will be performed to those patients who are capable of performing certain physical activities only, right? And next one is exercise stress testing. So now we will see what is exercise stress testing, what is the procedure of exercise stress testing, what are the equipments required, and what is the pre-test procedures, means before performing this EST, what kind of things to care to be taken, and the test procedure, what is the procedure of it. And next, a modified test procedure, like we have seen there is a modified Bruce protocol, that one we will see. And next one is monitors, what it monitors, like after performing or while performing this test, what the doctor will monitor. Next one, contraindications and advantages and disadvantages of this exercise stress test, right? So coming to the first part, what is the purpose of this one? So the purpose of this one is to find out patient who is having heart related problems like coronary artery disease or myocardial infraction. Apart from that, ventricular aneurysm. So ventricular aneurysm means where there is a bulging of ventricles. Right, when you see the ventricles are the major part or the major areas of the heart. The heart is a major part of the body, obviously means all the parts are major in the body, are important, having their own activities. In the heart, when the blood, the deoxygenated blood, when it enters into the ventricles, it has to pump to the lungs for purification. And when there is a oxygenated blood which reaches the ventricles of the heart, it has to pump that oxygenated blood to different parts of the body, right? When there is a bulging of the ventricles, the depolarization and repolarization won't be happening properly, means contraction and relaxation of ventricle won't happen properly. That bulging of the ventricle, we call it as a ventricular aneurysm. And next one, the other reason why we'll perform this, or what is the other purpose of performing this test, is to find out the functional capacity of the heart, means how much amount or how which part of the heart or how much functioning capacity of the heart is still remaining in a patient's body, right? So this is a purpose. Any disease condition, we can be find out or to see the functioning capacity of the person's heart. And next, requirements. What are the requirements? What are the things we need to perform this exercise stress test? Means, first one is you need a treadmill or upright bicycle. Second one, you need an ECG machine with 12 leads. And third one is oxygen sensor. And next, a BP measurement. BP measurement like with the help of spirometers or any other BP monitoring machine. Next, you need a stopwatch and you need sticky pads and clips. So these sticky pads and clips are used along with the ECG machines, right? So these are the requirements. So now we will see, like I said, we need a treadmill, like we have a treadmill here, right? Apart from treadmill, we said we need a ECG machine. We have this ECG workstation here, ECG machine with 12 electrodes or 12 leads attached to different parts of the body, like to the limbs and to the chest part and all. And next one, I said we need oxygen sensor to see the partial saturation oxygen, means VXO2, and the blood pressure to see the vitals before and after or while performing the exercise, right? So these are the things what we said we need to perform a exercise stress test or cardiac stress test. And going to next, what is pre-test procedures or pre-procedural procedures, means before perform the test, what are the things we have to take in care, what are the things we have to perform? First and foremost thing, you have to explain the test procedure to the patient, how you are going to do to him and what you are going to do to him. So after explaining it, you have to take a consent form. So consent form means you explain to the patient why you are going to do this test, and what are the advantages, what are the disadvantages of it, what you are going to achieve out of this test. You have to explain to this patient, you have to take a signature on a consent form by the patient. Next one is physical activity readiness questionnaire. So person who will undergo this exercise test may or may not fill this physical activity readiness questionnaire. That we will see next slide. What are the questions you should be present in this physical activity readiness questionnaire, right? And next one, you have to take a patient demographics or medication history. If the patient is having certain asthmatic problems or those kind of things, then we cannot ask patient to perform this test. Next, we have to take the baseline parameters, or we have to know all the baseline vitals. Means what is normal heart rate, normal blood pressure, normal oxygen, partial oxygen saturation at a normal when person is not doing any work, right? And the next one is calibrate and adjust equipment as per patient needs. So when we say calculate and adjust equipment, means it is about treadmill, like at which speed and at which slope incline position we have to perform, we have to start those things. Next one is we have to see the appropriate environmental conditions. It means that so to perform an exercise test in a treadmill, you need a nice room where there is no much disturbances and there is not at all a disturbances, right? So if you are not, if you cannot see these things here, attach another slide where you can see all the things properly, right? So what is the physical activity readiness question? That we'll see now. So this is a modified German made physical activity readiness questionnaire where you'll be having a set of questions. In normal physical activity readiness question, we'll be having only the 7 questions, and this 8th and 9th question can be used for pregnant also. This is modified German questionnaire where you can see different kinds of questions, like did your doctor explain you about this procedure, or did your doctor told you to perform only specific physical activities, or do you feel dizziness when you perform this, do you have any oxygen or any breathing related problems, or do you feel cold or cough when you perform this test. Like this, there is a number of 9 number of questions. So after filling this one only, we'll be seeing the patient can perform the test or not, right guys? So going to the next one, yeah, we said Bruce protocol, or so as we are dealing with the test procedure now. So what is a Bruce protocol, right? So Bruce, his full name is Robert Arthur Bruce, right? He is an American cardiologist, and he is also considered as the father of exercise physiology. He also considered the father of exercise physiology, and the Bruce has introduced this Bruce protocol in the year 1963, right? So what is the Bruce protocol? So what happens in Bruce protocol means, so we'll be asking the person to exercise or to walk in a treadmill, which is uphill, means where there is inclined in position of the treadmill. Like it won't be horizontal slopes. Slant means the horizontal is straight plane won't be there. There is a somewhat uphill position, right? And next, the person who is performing this treadmill procedure, to that person will be attaching the ECG machine and the lids, right? And next we'll be attaching the oxygen sensor attached to him. And now we will see, we'll monitor the blood pressure also. So if you can see this video, so what are the things we can do? So person who is according to the Bruce protocol, how can we perform this exercise test? It means these are the things, right? The person will walk and the ECG attaches. If you can see, so this is inclined position. If you can see here upright, this is not straight. This is somewhat inclined in position here. So here there is inclined position where the person is walking on a treadmill, where if you can see here, the ECG machine, the electrodes are attached to the person and a nurse who is performing the BP measures. What is the normal BP? And when there is continuous increase in BP or not. And next one is oxygen sensor has been attached to the finger to see the partial oxygen. What is the increased oxygen demand in the body? What is VXO? VXO is a measure how we'll check this required oxygen in the body, right? And we don't need much in detail about this now. So our next one here is the Bruce protocol totally contains 7 stages, right? So we're in every stage. Supposing once you complete stage 1, right? So your stage 1 will be there for 3 minutes. So once you complete phase 1 for 3 minutes, right, you'll go for stage 2. When you are going for stage 2, the speed of the treadmill, means at the rate which you walk on treadmill, the speed and the inclined position, like I shown in the previous slides, the inclined position of the treadmill, right? So every 3 minutes and for every stage, there is an increase in the speed or rate at which you will walk on treadmill. Along with that, the inclined position of treadmill also will be increased. So now we'll see in detail. So in your in a performing treadmill test, so these are the different stages, stage 1 to 7, where when you see all the 7 stages, there is a different speed and different percent grade means increase in the inclined position of the treadmill, right? So stage 1 is 1.7 mph or kmph at 10% grade increase, and stage 7 at 6 kilometers per hour, 22% grade, and only healthy people and athletes can perform till end of this protocol. It means stage 7, and most of the people will drop in between stage 3 and stage 4, right? And next one, I just gave the details here, Bruce protocol. So stage 1 to 7 mph per hour, right, and 10% grade means increase in the slant of the shoot of the treadmill, right? And next one here is modified Bruce protocol. So here what they are saying is, in modified Bruce protocol, what that is, the first the stage 1 and stage 2 here are warm up stages which last for 3 minutes each. Means, so in stage 1 and stage 2, in, you can see here, stage 1 and stage 2, the rate of speed, means the rate at which you walk on treadmill, is same, 1.7 mph. And in stage 1, it is 0 grade. So when we see in normal Bruce protocol, we said the person will walk starting directly in an uphill position. Whereas in modified Bruce protocol, there won't be uphill position, there will be a stride map which will rotate on treadmill on which you will walk. And in stage 2, only 5% will be increased. Whereas in your normal Bruce protocol, in stage 1, there will be increase of 10%, means starting with 10%, and stage 2 will be going for 12 to 14% grade increase, right? So this thing will be used for older individuals, means who are aged and who cannot perform the exercise rapidly, we'll be using that one, right? As we see here, like I said in this previous slide, so treadmill is initially horizontal rather than uphill. Like you can see this one, 0 grade, means there is no uphill position, increase slant position, right? And stage 2 is only 5%. See, if you can see here, with the first few intervals, increasing the treadmill slope only. Means in these 2 intervals, there is only increase of the treadmill slope, and there is no increase of the rate at which the person walks on a treadmill. Right, guys, hope you understand the difference between modified Bruce protocol and normal Bruce protocol, right? And next one, what it monitors, means what your ECG monitors are, what your exercise stress test monitor, means your exercise stress test monitors your heart rate, breathing of the person, oxygen, how much oxygen is saturated oxygen in a person's blood, and what is the blood pressure of the person. What is the ECG, means what are the changes in the ECG. So in previous classes, we have seen about the increase, PQRST waves, when it will increase, when it will decrease, all those changes will be seen in a person. So what is the thing with ECG here, means, so as I said, you'll be taking the baseline parameters when you're performing your stress test. So first you will attach the ECG to the patient. You will take the recordings of QPRST waves and heart pumping and all those things, like PQRST wave, normal waves. Like if you can see here, we'll be having this, this one is a T wave, QRS complex, and this is a T wave. This is in case of normal person. So when you, normal person in a sense, when you don't perform any exercise, right? But when you are performing exercise, when there is increased metabolic rate in the body, when there is increased oxygen demand in the body, if the person's heart is working properly, there won't be any problem. But if person's heart is not working properly, definitely you will be seeing any problems here. Like if there is a ST wave depression here, instead of this one is called, we call it ST, this part ST wave, right? This one is S and this one is T, so the middle part is ST wave. So when there is a depression of ST wave, we can say there is a problem with ventricular repolarization, means there is a problem with relaxation of ventricles of the heart, right? So like this, there is a different parts or different waves, different like PQRST waves, each wave will having a similar importance, right? So we'll be performing this one, we'll be monitoring this one with the help of this exercise stress test. So apart with this, apart from this, what we'll test is we'll be seeing the duration of exercise, means at which rate or what is the duration, like the person completes stage one, stage two, stage three. If person complete only stage one, it means the person has done the work only for 3 minutes of duration, like that, right? If a person has done this Bruce protocol for 21 minutes, it means when he can complete all the 7 stages, he has done the workout for 21 minutes. So like that, duration of exercise and total workload, how much his heart can take in. And next one is maximum heart rate. Right, when the person reaches maximum heart rate and where he cannot perform further exercise, we have to stop the test, right? And next one, what are the symptoms which has been occurred to the patient because of this exercise stress test? Means there is a tachycardia was there, or there is a breathing problem was there for that patient, and all those things. Next, what are the ECG changes, and what are the blood pressure changes in the patient's body? Right, that one will be taken care of. These are the measurements. This one are the monitoring or measurements which will be done with the help of this exercise stress test. And next one is contraindication. People who cannot perform this exercise stress test means orthopedic patient, as I said, a person who is having orthopedic problems like joint problems, knee joint problem, he cannot perform, so we cannot do this. Next, persons who is having neurological and peripheral vascular problems. So neurological problem in the sense where the person has certain neurological issues where their body's voluntary movements are not coordinated with each other. Suppose if you are working properly on a road or somewhere, it means our neurological system is working properly where we can walk properly. But if a person is having neurological disorders, so a person cannot walk because of neurological issues. Next one is peripheral vascular problems, like we have deep vein thrombosis where person cannot walk for long time, those kind of things. So these are the major contraindication who cannot perform this exercise stress test or EST. Next one is termination, means as I said, the exercise stress test according to Bruce protocol will last for 21 minutes and 7 stages. But in between, if patients have certain difficulties, we have to stop it, right? Those indication when we have to stop this exercise stress test has been given by American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. So now we will see what are the points or what are situations where we have to stop this thing, right? So moderate to severe angina symptoms, if person is having a heart pain or angina symptoms, we have to stop it. And if the person's systolic blood pressure is stopped by 10 mmHg when compared to normal, suppose normal blood pressure for adult is 120/80, right, systole by diastole. So if the systolic blood pressure dropped by 10 mm, means instead of 120, if it has reduced to 100 mm per Hg, like that, then we have to stop it. Next one, if the person's nervous system symptoms increase, like ataxia, where there is a breathing difficulties, or if a person faints, dizziness, those kind of condition, we have to stop. Next one is signs of poor perfusion, means pallor. So we have 5-6 cardinal symptoms like pallor, ictus, cyanosis, clubbing, and the remaining things. So pallor and cyanosis means where person body is not receiving the enough amount of blood which they need. See, when the blood cannot be pumped or reached to different parts of the body in liquid positions, what happened? There is a loss of oxygen supply. Like when you see the oxygen supply in the body, it has to supply through the blood. Both the nutrients and the oxygen will pass to different parts of the body with help of blood only, right? And next one, in case of technical difficulties of treadmill or AC machine, we have to stop it. Next, when the subject want to stop, where he cannot perform, we have to stop. Next one, ventricular arrhythmias, like ventricular tachycardia, means where is a rapid change in the heart rate or heart pumping, then we have to stop it. Next one, when we see ST segment depression, like I already explained, ST segment depression will happen when there is a problem with the ventricular repolarization, means when there is relaxation of ventricles, there is a problem. See, what happens there means the heart won't relax, the ventricles of the heart won't relax properly. Again, it starts contracting, right? Those kind of things. So all these conditions, in all these conditions, we have to terminate the procedure. Next one, advantageous means we can see the maximum heart rate of a person, and we can use that one as an example, and we can use that one in the training for other people. Disadvantages, like it is required a large time and cost is required. There is it costs more when compared to other tests. And next, we need a special trained person to perform this test again. And next one is when can we get the blunt responses? Means suppose thing we are inducing a stress to the patient, right? And when you give certain beta blockers and calcium channel blockers to the person, what happens? It won't increase. It won't show the proper response of this test, right? The mechanisms like this based upon the beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. So I will explain you one thing here. Calcium channel blockers. So what happens? We need calcium for the contraction of the heart. So when you give this calcium channel blockers, what happens? The heart won't pump properly. Means the contraction of the heart, it won't be increased, right? The contraction of the heart won't increase. When the heart contraction won't increase rapidly, there won't be stress induced and we cannot perform or we cannot see the changes in the person's heart before and after performing exercises, right? So, and, so whatever we discuss, everything we have in this slide. So to whom we'll perform this exercise test, like person who is having coronary artery diseases and for non-coronary artery diseases also, how it works. And the exercise is for those people who can perform this exercise test and all, fine. And next one is about pharmacological stresses. So in the upcoming slides, we'll see about the pharmacological stress test. Hope you understand this exercise stress test. Right, next one is pharmacological stress test. So this pharmacological stress test will be performed for those patients who is having heart disease and who cannot perform exercise stress test because of the knee problems or joint problems or for some other reasons. So in pharmacological stress test, what they will do is the technician will give certain drugs to the patient where the stress will be induced in a patient without performing any exercise. So what happens here? When the person performs certain exercise activities, the metabolic rate in the body will increase. When there is increased metabolic rate in the person's body, they need more amount of nutrients and more amount of oxygen. When they need more amount of it, from where, as I said previously, from where we'll get the nutrients and oxygen supply to different parts of the body? Through the blood. So what happens when they need more amount of oxygen nutrients? The pumping of the blood should be more from the person's heart, right? So to give the stress, to give that increased pumping rate of heart in a person's body, in a person's heart. So what they will do, instead of exercise, they will use certain drugs like your vasodilators and positive inotropic agents. Your vasodilators, drugs like adenosine and diprednisone, and positive inotropic agents like dobutamine. So here, as the thing itself indicates, vasodilators, where there is a vasodilation happen to the different vasculatures in the different arteries, right? Inotropic, positive inotropic agents like dobutamine, it means it will increase the heart rate of the heart and will increase the blood flow of the heart. So now we'll see in detail about the mechanisms of the drugs and how the test will be done. So here, the both the drugs like vasodilators and positive inotropic agents, like I wrote both modalities in this, both the drugs. So what is the work here? Vasodilator response and increase the blood flow. So what happened? There is an increased blood flow, and when there is a increased blood flow and vasodilation response, we can see the difference between the normal arteries and coronary arteries. Means a person who is having coronary artery disease, in a sense. So when we can see this one, when you can say this is a normal artery where there is no blockage, right, and the blood is flowing properly. When you give these two drugs, the area for blood flow will be increased in normal arteries. Whereas for stenosed arteries, nothing but where there is a narrowing of blood ways because of any reasons, right? In here, as we are speaking about the cardiac heart, so we will see, if you can see this yellow color parts here. So this one is plague in the sense, there will be a deposition of fatty streaks, fat in the body. Cholesterol will be deposited here and calcium will be deposited here, which will narrow the blood flow. This is a stenosed arteries. So when you give these drugs, there will be increased blood flow in these normal arteries, and there won't be much increase or there won't be null increase in a stenosed arteries. So with this test, we can find out between the two arteries, where the arteries are normal in the heart and where there are stenosed or blocked arteries, right? So if you can see person's heart, so this is a normal arteries of a person's normal coronary artery where there is no blockage and there is a normal blood flow when you take cross section of this. And this is arterial wall. So what happened in case of stenosed arteries, because of this plaque formation, you can see cross section of this, the area of blood flow is decreased here. The area of blood flow is decreased here. So this condition we called as a stenosed artery, where the heart cannot pump the required blood to different parts of the body, right? So what happens when there is increased stenosed arteries? So this is a normal coronary artery disease where there is a minute plaque buildup in the normal arteries. So still there is a normal reduced, only few percent of blood flow is reduced. When the condition increases, it is angina, where you can see there is a decreased portion of blood flow. It is harder for the blood to get through the arteries because of this obstruction on the both sides. So this is angina, where we'll be having the chest pain, for which will be radiating towards the left shoulder. And that's how we can differentiate between normal cardiac burning and heart disease. The heart pain or the chest pain, which will be radiated towards the left shoulder. And when this condition increases, when the angina increases, it leads to heart attack, where you can see the normal narrow pathway here, normal flow of blood. So in heart attack, what happens? The plaque will break down, means this yellow color which has been deposited and obstructing the blood flow, it will break down, and the blood clot will block the arteries, means there won't be any blood flow. Then we can say the person is having heart problem, right? And next one, with this performing exercise stress test, as I said, in exercise stress test and pharmacological stress test, we'll be using myocardial perfusion imaging. So in, as I said, this myocardial perfusion imaging will be helpful for seeing the blood perfusion in different parts of the heart. So when you are puffing this myocardial perfusion test, we can use certain perfusion agents like radionucleotides like thallium-201, where we can see the clear representation of the arteries here. So if you can see this normal coronary artery, carotid artery, there is a normal blood flow. We don't have any obstruction. This is a normal thing. Whereas when you see the stenosed arteries here, there is a blockage. You can see here, constriction of this pathways, constriction of the blood vessels here. This is stenosed arteries. So when you use this radio ligand nucleotides or thallium-201, when you're performing this myocardial perfusion test, with the color, we can see a color image. What is the blood perfusion rate in different parts of the arteries of different parts of the body? So this image is from the wall shear counter 3 method, which is one of the best method to see the perfusion of the heart in the blood, perfusion of the blood in the heart. Right, so you can see the heterogeneity, means the difference between two arteries, normal carotid artery and the stenosed carotid artery, will be visualized clearly. Right, next one, I said we are going to use two drugs, adenosine and the dipyridamole. So adenosine is a drug which will act on vasodilator receptors, right, A2A receptor, and dipyridamole will block the cellular reabsorption of the endogenous adenosine. So the mechanism we will see in detail now, what is involved. Right, when you see the first one, your adenosine has a different effects, like when it will act on different attach and different receptors, the action will vary. Right, so when you see this thing, the adenosine will act on A2A, A2B, A1 and A3 receptors. So we need about A2A. So when it will act on A2A, it leads to coronary vasodilation, where you can differentiate between normal artery and stenosed artery, and it will cause peripheral vasodilation also. Both the things will be happen when your adenosine will act on coronary vasodilation and peripheral vasodilation. So when it will act on A2B, it leads to peripheral vasodilation and mast cell degranulation, bronchoconstriction, where we don't need this activity at present. Next, when it act on A1, it leads to negative AV conduction, negative chronotropy and inotropy, where we don't need that one now. And it will act, when it act on A3 receptors, it leads to mast cell degradation, bronchoconstriction. So we have this adenosine endogenously also, but in this test, we are going to give exogenously, means from outside. So as what we can do here, we can give a analyte or a one of component or modified adenosine called as reg adenosine. So this reg adenosine will act only on A2A, which we'll be using in our test. So what this adenosine will do is, this adenosine means your adenosine triphosphate. So this adenosine will convert from adenosine triphosphate to cyclic adenosine monophosphate, CAMP. So when there is an increased CAMP release in the body, it leads to smooth muscle relaxation. It leads to smooth muscle relaxation, which in turn leads to vasodilation. So your blood vessels are consist of smooth muscle because we need arteries pumping and all those things. So your smooth muscles will be a part of your arteries. So when there is a relaxation of smooth muscles, when the muscles will relax, the dilation of the arteries will happen. This is how your vasodilation activity of this thing will happen. But the major problem here is your adenosine will be reuptaken by cellular matrix or cellular immunity. That we will see in next slide, how your dipyridamole indirectly, how your dipyridamole will indirectly increase, cause or increase the vasodilation. So how it causes is, so when you see this adenosine and dipyridamole, right? So what is this dipyridamole? So dipyridamole is a phosphodiesterase enzyme, right? Your dipyridamole is a phosphodiesterase enzyme, which will block the cellular reuptake of the endogenous adenosine. So when it will block the cellular reuptake of endogenous adenosine, what happens? More amount of adenosine will be present in the circulation. Like it will increase to 3 to 4% than the normal thing. So when that thing will happen, it will act on ACE receptor. Like your adenosine will act on A2 receptors, which will increase the production of cyclic AMP, like we have seen here, which will increase the production of cyclic AMP, right? Cyclic AMP and cyclic adenosine monophosphate. So this cyclic adenosine monophosphate will help for vasodilation by a mechanism called as, where it will relax the vascular smooth muscles. Vascular smooth muscles will be relaxed and vasodilated, which in turn increase the blood flow, which will increase the myocardial perfusion also by 3 to 7 times. Means normal perfusion rate, supposing certain X normal perfusion rate, so it leads to increase to 3 to 7 times of this vasodilation of vasculature of the arteries will be happened, right? Generally when you use this drug, the normal half-life of the dipyridamole is 30 to 45 minutes, and when you induce the dipyridamole to the person, this hyperemic effect, when we see there is increased blood flow in the starting of the topic, pharmacological stress, this hyperemic activity means increased blood, heart pumping blood flow will be there for 15 minutes. And once you give a drug, after 6.5 minutes, the effect of the drug on the body will start. Right? I hope you understand the mechanism, right? So this adenosine will convert to, this A2 receptor is a positive effect of adenosine. Will be acting on adenyl cyclase, where we need a conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP, cyclic adenosine monophosphate, which will relax the smooth muscles. So once there is a relaxation of smooth muscles, there is a vasodilation will happen, right? So the other thing here, what we are going to check here is the next one. Like I said, the vasodilation by these two drugs, adenosine and dipyridamole, will increase coronary blood flow by 3 to 5 times than the normal thing, and there won't be any blood flow increase in stenosed arteries. Yeah, this is obviously normal arteries and stenosed arteries. Yeah, same thing again, normal arteries and stenosed arteries where the blood will look hard, which can cause heart disease. Next one, dobutamine. What is the thing with dobutamine? Like I said, it will increase the blood flow. So dobutamine will increase the myocardial contraction when there is increased heart contraction, which leads to increased heart rate. When there is increased heart rate, more amount of blood is pumped with the help where it will be increased blood pressure. So this dobutamine will have agonist and antagonist both, right? This dobutamine, when it will act on alpha 1 receptor, has a agonism activity where it will leads to vasoconstriction. But when this positive dobutamine will act on alpha 1 antagonism, like we have agonism and antagonism. So this antagonism will lead to vasodilation, where there will be a null vascular effect, means there won't be any dilation or contraction, increase in the heart rate contraction. Whereas your positive dobutamine will act on beta receptors, beta 1 and beta 2, both of which will be having agonism. These things will lead to beta 1 agonism of this dobutamine will lead to inotropism, and beta 2 agonism of this will lead to tachycardia, where there is increased cardiac output and decreased vascular resistance. As because there is increased cardiac output, there will be a increased blood pressure. Let me explain you once again. So this positive dobutamine will act on beta 1 and beta 2 agonist receptors, where we'll be having agonism activities. where this beta 1 will leads to inotropism and beta 2 agonism leads to tachycardia, whereas when you act this alpha 1 is also an agonism, this one also will leads to increased inotropism, with which there will be increased cardiac output and increased blood pressure. This is how your dobutamine will increase the heart rate or blood pressure, right? Next, so when you see this dobutamine, so this coronary blood flow in the normal arteries will be increased by 2 to 4 times when compared to stenosed arteries from the baseline. That with the help of these two drugs, the person will be getting that much effect what he got after performing an exercise on treadmill, right? This is pharmacology while inducing stress to the patient with the help of the drugs, right? And other thing, in a performing this pharmacological stress test, there are certain things which person cannot do, like person cannot take certain medication, he cannot take certain foods. Like take example of your methyl xanthine. So methyl xanthine is the thing which will be having a blockage effect of adenosine, with which there will be a problem of the test. We don't get normal results. So the doctor might ask you to not to take certain methyl xanthine derivative products like coca products, coffee, tea, those kind of things, where your coca, coffee, and tea are more sources of methyl xanthine, right? Next one is myocardial perfusion extract, myocardial perfusion test. Like I said, we are going to use thallium-201. And this radiopharmaceutical agent is directly proportional to the coronary blood flow. If there is a more coronary blood flow, more amount of this one will be absorbed. And there is a less amount of blood flow in stenotic arteries, there will be less amount of this, right? So with this thing, we can just see the difference between the tissue supplied with normal arteries and the stenosed arteries. Like you can see, this is a normal artery and stenosed arteries. Like we already explained this, with the help of radioligand agent, we can clearly see this one, normal arteries and stenosed means narrowed arteries here, right? Yeah, this is thing what we have discussed till now. This is entire summary of it. Like what is extra cardiac stress testing or exercise stress testing, right? Which indicates it, what are the indication, who is at risk of CAD, person is having stable chest pain will be performed stress test, and non-coronary artery disease like evaluation of valvular heart disease, those kind of things will be done, and in exercise stress test, this is the heart rate and all those kind of things. And next in the pharmacology, we are going to use vasodilators and partial inotropes like dobutamine, beta 1, beta 2 agonist, and vasodilators like adenosine, dipyridamole, and rigodosine. Rigodosine is the other next product of adenosine. That way, there is cyclic AMP, increased production, relaxation of smooth muscles we have seen. And it's contradictory for those patients who is having hypertension, all those kind of things. And inotropes, patients with ventricular arrhythmias cannot take this inotrope, dobutamine, where you have to go for other tests. Whereas the dipyridamole is indicated by FDA and WHO, where we can use this drug for exercise stress test, right? This is it, guys, about your exercise and pharmacological stress test. Hope you understand it. Thank you so much. And the previous topics are being given in different videos in YouTube. You can just check it. You can just